I'm Roman Yossi of the Nashville Predators.
I'm Dante Fabro of the Nashville Predators.
This is Philip Forsberg of the Nashville Predators.
I'm Colton Sissons of the Nashville Predators.
I'm Eustace Arros of the Nashville Predators.
You're listening to the Renegades of Puck
with Crazy Charlie.
Welcome to the Bunker. Welcome to the Renegades of Puck podcast. I'm your host and captain, Crazy Charlie Sonny. And before we get started on the No Half Step in Hockey coverage, first, let me direct you to our home website, renegadesofpuck.com. Once you go to renegadesofpuck.com, you learn everything you need to know about the show. Once you're getting educated about the show, you can click on that merchandise tab. Take you straight to our classic logo t-shirt, our pride logo t-shirt, all of our different special event t-shirts, and so much more. All the gimmicks you've come to love and understand and accept from the Renegades of Puck are all still available in our online store, whether that's socks, throw pillows, wall art, bed sets. Well, let's face it, we've sold out so that you can buy in. We sure do appreciate everyone out there for picking up some Renegades of Puck merchandise. Social media is of critical importance to this hockey operation, so please listen up. Here's how you can support the Renegades of Puck. You can find us on Threads, Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, and yes, we are still on X. Please give us a like, give us a follow along on any or all of those different platforms. YouTube, thank you so much to all of our brand new subscribers. Just search Renegades of Puck, give us a subscription today, turn on those notifications buttons, and you'll know when the latest videos come out, whether that's game previews, game recaps, full episodes of Renegades of Puck TV, whatever it is, it's right there on our YouTube channel. So again, we appreciate each and every one of you for jumping in the trenches with the Renegades of Puck. When it comes to the audio podcast, the Full Press Predators podcast on the Full Press NHL Network is doing incredible. From local to global in 2023, approaching 7 million downloads, replays, and listens for the entire year. So again, stick taps, love, and respect to everybody working behind the scenes and doing such an incredible job assisting the Renegades of Puck. Now, Venmo, that's how you can support your Renegades of Puck by financially. Just search Renegades of Puck in Venmo or scan the QR code that is currently on your screen. Thanks to generous benefactors just like you listening and watching right now, we've been able to keep this independent operation going for the last almost 3 years now, and we're looking to continue building on the future. Behind the scenes, we need a lot of help, so any dollar will go a long way, and it goes directly to assisting the Renegades of Puck. So that's Venmo. That's how you can financially support the Renegades of Puck. Now listen, I know it's time for the No Half Step in Hockey coverage, so let me deliver the goods. Time for operation number 822. Up there. That's right, show number 822. And at this moment in hockey history, the Nashville Predators currently find themselves in 7th place in the Central Division. After 16 games skated on the season, they have a record of 6-10. They have 12 points. Their next game will take place on home ice, where they have a record of 4-4. They will be facing off against the Colorado Avalanche, who are currently in 2nd place in the Central Division, 10 points ahead of the Nashville Predators. On the road, the Colorado Avalanche have a record of 6-3. Their overall record is 11-5-0, 22 points, has the Avs 1 point shy of 1st place Dallas. Let's start with the first place Dallas Stars, work our way backwards through the Central Division, and then we'll microscope down into this matchup between the Preds and the Avs. Dallas Stars are in first place in the Central with 23 points. Colorado Avalanche, second place with 22. The Winnipeg Jets also have 22 points. The Arizona Coyotes are in fourth place at 18 points. St. Louis has 17. Minnesota at 13. Nashville has 12 in seventh place. And Chicago Blackhawks have 10 points and are in eighth place overall. The Blackhawks have skated in the least amount of games in the Central Division, though. The Colorado Avalanche have scored 62 goals in the season. They've given up 49 against, while the Predators have scored 48 on the season, given up 54 against. It's the first of 3 regular season meetings between these Central Division rivals. The Nashville Predators will host the Colorado Avalanche again on March the 2nd. So these two teams will not play again until March. And then on March the 30th will be the Nashville Predators' only trip to Colorado this season. Now, once the Nashville Predators are wrapped up with this particular Monday game against the Colorado Avalanche of Thanksgiving week, Wednesday they'll face off against the Calgary Flames. On Friday, they'll travel to St. Louis for a day game. Back home Sunday versus Winnipeg, then close out the month of November on the 28th versus Pittsburgh and the 30th versus Minnesota on home ice. Colorado Avalanche, let's take a look at their most recent stretch of hockey. Let's take a look at their previous 5 games to see how the trends are going. We go back to November the 9th, and it was a 4-3 loss versus the Seattle Kraken. On November the 11th, an 8-2 loss versus the St. Louis Blues, but then the Avalanche turned things around. On the 13th of November, a 5-1 win at Seattle, followed that with an 8-2 win on the 15th, and that was versus the Anaheim Ducks. And most recently, on the 18th, it was a 6-3 win at the Dallas Stars. So the Colorado Avalanche started the season red hot and then had a big saddle dip right there, and now are back on a 3-game winning streak. Coming into this game in the matchup, the NHL rankings and numbers are as follows. The Nashville Predators are averaging 3 goals per game. That is 20th overall in the NHL. When it comes to the Colorado Avalanche, 3.81 goals per game is third best in the National Hockey League. Goals against, the Preds are giving up 3.38 per game. That is down to 22nd overall in the league, while the Colorado Avalanche are giving up 3.06 per game. That is 12th. The shots on goal category, the Nashville Predators 30.7 is 18th in the NHL, while the Colorado Avalanche, impressive, 34.3 shots on goal per game is second best in the NHL. In their shots against category, let's start with the Avs, 27.7 against per game is third best in the NHL. So second in shots for, third in shots against for the Colorado Avalanche, while the Nashville Predators are 10th in the league in shots against, 29.8 shots given up per game. In the special teams bonanza, the power play for Nashville Predators, 21.2% conversion rate is 13th best in the NHL. 14 out of 66 is your raw data, while the Colorado Avalanche converting at 19.1%, they're 20th in the NHL. You would expect more from them, but still be aware. 12 out of 63 is the raw data. On the PK, 71.2% kill rate for the Nashville Predators is 30th in the NHL. The Colorado Avalanche are considerably better, 85.9% kill rate, fifth best in the NHL. The Avs have given up 9 power play goals against in the season, while the Preds have given up 15 power play goals against on the season. Injury update for the Nashville Predators. Shen still listed on IR and no timetable for his return. Tommy Novak, potentially another 3 to 5 weeks on injured reserve. And Ryan McDonagh has been listed as day-to-day for quite some time now. Thought he would have been back in the lineup for the game that we are about to recap, but still no go for Ryan McDonagh. Mark Delgazzo has been sent back down to Milwaukee, and Stastny has been recalled, and we're about to talk about him because he's going to get his first start. Now, when it comes to every team in the NHL, they have high-skilled, high-powered individual players. So we always talk about the top 5 individual scorers from each team and the potential goaltending matchup. Let's start on the impressive Colorado Avalanche side of things. Cale Makar is leading the team in scoring. 4 goals and 20 assists for 24 points. Those 20 assists pace the Colorado Avalanche in that category. Mikko Rantanen has 11 goals and 12 assists for 23 points. Those 11 goals pace the Avs in total goals. McKinnon has 6 and 14 for 20, always lethal against Nashville Predators. Nichushkin 6 and 7 for 13, and then Taves 2 and 8 for 10. On the Nashville Predators side of things, Philip Forsberg continues to lead the team in scoring. 7 goals and now 12 assists for 19 points. The 12 assists marks the number one spot for assists by a Nashville Predator. O'Reilly's 8 goals is leading the team in goals. 8 plus 7 for 15 for O'Reilly. Tommy Novak on injured reserve, still 3rd on the team in scoring with 6 and 6 for 12. The captain, Romy Josi, 3 and 8 for 11. And Nyquist moving up the charts here. 2 goals, 8 assists for 10 total points. When it comes to the netminders, UC Saros anticipated to get the start in this game. 4-9-0 on the season, 8-9-2 save percentage, 3.23 goals against average. Those numbers need to improve. They need to start improving quickly. But I wanted to throw Kevin Lankinen's numbers in here too, because I wanted to update his numbers due to his recent start. He's 2-1-0 on the season now, a 9-10 save percentage, 2.73 goals against average. Georgiev over for the Colorado Avalanche, off to a great start to the season. The win-loss record is great, but the other numbers you would expect to be a lot better. 10-4-0 is the record. Again, highly impressive, but 890 save percentage, 3.01 goals against average. He is certainly a goaltender that is struggling to find his game right now as well. UC Saros versus Georgiev could be a highly interesting matchup in goal, as neither of them are playing up to their full potential at this point in time. That's going to get you all set up for the Nashville Predators Colorado Avalanche Monday to start Thanksgiving week. I know a lot of you are heading out on the road and traveling and might not have an opportunity to catch this game live. So just remember, we will have it right here covered from the bunker. Renegades Puck will be all over it. We will be here working all week. We'll have every single one of the games for the holiday weekend covered as well. So that's got you set up. We got to go back though, and we got to talk about the Nashville Predators' most recent game against the Chicago Blackhawks. It was another afternoon game. It was the first time the Preds met up against the Hawks. It was the battle for the basement in the Central Division. It's called the Rebirth Sports Full Game Recap, and it's coming up right after this on the Renegades of Puck Podcast.
Hockey players are as unique as the game itself, and your uniform should be tailored to fit you. Rebirth Sports is your sports apparel tailor. From shells, bags, warm-ups, hats, hoodies, branding, and more, let Rebirth Sports be your custom hockey tailor.
And don't forget to tell them they do more than just hockey.
Rebirth Sports on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Rebirth Sport, a match made in hockey.
It's now time for the Rebirth Sports full game recap. We go all the way back to November 18th of the year 2023 when the Nashville Predators were having a matinee showing versus the Chicago Blackhawks. Head coach Andrew Burnett deployed his line combinations in the following way. Forsberg, O'Reilly, and Nyquist. Sherwood, Glass, and Evangelista. Trennan, Parson, and Sissons. Smith, McCarron, and Tomasino make up your fourth line. Your defensive pairings are Yossi and Fabro, Luzon, and Carrier. Still no Ryan McDonough. Stastny getting his first opportunity of the season, and Barry now down there on the third pair with Lankinen getting the very rare home start for the backup goaltender. We are just 26 seconds into the game, and it's Alex Carey off to the box. 2 minutes for cross-checking, so we'll get that first special team scenario immediately. Lankinen would come up with a save on Perry. It would be the first shot on goal of the game. Then Trennan would put up an incredibly strong penalty kill shift and some good work out there. 2:33 in the first period. Lankinen comes up with a save on Foligno at 3:13. Lankinen a save on Johnson at the 3:38 mark. Soderblom comes up with a save on Philip Forsberg's first shot on goal for the Nashville Predators at 3:56 of the first period. Soderblom comes up with a save on Yossi plus his follow-up jam. 5:56 into the first period. Kevin Lankinen coming up with a save on Donato. Soderblom back to work at 7:07 of the first period with a save on Sherwood plus the rebound follow-up by Glass. Some good back and forth and some good pace to the game here early in the first period. At 11:06 of the first, it's Hall pass to the slot. He cannot connect. He tried to outwait on the two-on-one. Delay, delay, delay. Throw the pass to the slot. Does not connect. There was a wide-open net there on the play. Lankinen is able to survive this situation, then come up with a big save on Reichel just a few seconds later through some pretty intensely heavy traffic there in front of him. At 12:07 of the first period, Jakob Trennan's first goal of the season. We've been waiting on this one for a long time. It's a shot from the high slot off of the D, just enough of a deflection to make a difference. Parsons' screen also making a difference on this play for Jakob Trennan. Good to see him on the score sheet. His first of the season gives the Nashville Predators a 1-0 lead here in the first period of Bridgestone Arena. 14:13 of the first period, it's Reichel off to the box. 2 minutes for holding on Parsons. Parsons again doing a really good job bringing the effort out there and staying on his skates. Lankinen comes up with a shorthanded save on Vlasic's breakaway, a really big moment early in this game. Parsonen loses the handle on the between the legs move in the slot, does not get the shot on goal. 17:12 of the first period, Perry is off the box. 2 minutes for tripping on Tomasino to the delight of the Nashville Predators fans at Bridgestone Arena. O'Reilly would catch iron on this power play before Nyquist would put the puck in the net for his second goal of the season. It was a rebound kick from the blade to the stick blade and in. This is good grease right here. This was a good hard-working goal. Nyquist, O'Reilly both on each side of the blue paint working hard to get the rebound. It was Nyquist who was able to get to it first, and the good quick move to kick it to the stick blade was so good and slick that they had to go ahead and take a quick look at it. But obviously a very, very good goal. Highlight reel worthy grease on this one. Nashville Predators hold a 2-0 lead here on the power play goal by Nyquist at the end of the first period, out shooting Chicago 13-9. We are 1:30 into the second period. Lankinen coming up with a save on Hall after Barry's terrible turnover backing into his own zone could not control the puck. At 1:48 of the second period, Lankinen coming up with a save on Hall. 4:42, Lankinen a save on Bedard. A choppy first 5 minutes between both of these teams. No pace at all. A lot of whistles. Soderblom comes up with a save at 5:47 of the first period on Stastny. It's the first shot on goal for Nashville in the second period. 6:33, Lankinen comes up with a save on Foligno. 7:20, Lankinen a save on Hall. 9:10, Lankinen a save on Jones with a big kick out right here, trying to get rid of that rebound all by himself. Soderblom back to work at the middle point of the period at 10:12. The Nashville Predators finally starting to get their skates under them in this period. They were into a defensive shell for the first 10 minutes, trying to protect that 2-goal lead. And Soderblom has to come up with a save right here. Luzon backhander, second shot on goal of the period, only for the Nashville Predators halfway through the period. 10:43, Lankinen a save on Reichel. 12:26, Lankinen a save on Donato's backhand. Post sealed very well on the short side, not allowing any scoring opportunity. But at 13:05, while the Preds are continuing to be in that defensive shell, it's Kurashev's third goal of the season. It's a rebound jam on Bedard's shot. Chicago's net front was just owning it on this play. Kurashev doing a great job. Nashville Predators did not do a very good job, especially Luzon in particular on this battle. Nashville still leads 2-1, 13:05 into the second period, 13:43 of the second period. Soderblom coming up to save on Parsonen at close range. Parsonen doing a good job getting in there for that scoring opportunity. 15:01, Lankinen back to work on Kuchinski. 16:20, it's Cole Smith getting the Nashville Predators an incredibly greasy goal, going to the hard area and getting the job done. His third goal of the season is a double rebound jam. The setup in the corner work by McCarron, then Tomasino puts the puck on the net, and then it's Cole Smith digging the first rebound opportunity out and then getting to the second rebound opportunity before anyone else could and putting that puck into the empty net. An incredibly good, hard-working effort goal by Cole Smith on this one for his third goal of the season, and also for the Nashville Predators, their third team goal, giving them a 3-1 lead and their 2-goal lead restored. At 16:55 of the second period, Perry off the box, 2 minutes for tripping on Cole Smith. So Smith just scored the goal, now draws a power play for his Nashville Predators. Soderblom comes up with a save on Forsberg. Glass brings the jam. Nashville Predators unable to convert on this power play, and the final minutes of the period go by rather quietly. Nashville now out shooting Chicago 23-18 for the game and leading 3-1. We flip over to the back of the sheet, and just like we started the first period, we start the third period with a penalty in the first minute against the Nashville Predators. 55 seconds in, Trenin's off the box, 2 minutes for high sticking. This came in the offensive zone, whipping around to try to get to the puck, but he whipped the stick recklessly, and we're all responsible for the stick out there on the ice. Lankinen comes up with a save on Jones. That is Seth Jones. Lankinen then comes up with a save on Perry, and another save on Hall. Lankinen standing tall on this particular penalty kill situation yet again for the Nashville Predators team. 3:15, just after the penalty expires, Lankinen comes up with a save on Radish at 4:36 of the third period. It's Soderblom coming up with a save on McCarron. He used his head while he was down on his belly, kind of a cobra situation, and it ricocheted off of the post after going off of the mask of Soderblom. And McCarron making a difference in this game again. 5:08 of the third period, Soderblom's able to save on Luzon. 7:27 of the third period, Lankinen coming up with a save on Kurashev, plus a follow-up by Foligno. 8:53 of the third period, it's Soderblom coming up with a save on Sherwood at 10:38 of the third period. Soderblom, another save on Nyquist, and his backhand off of the rush. Nashville Predators doing a good job of continuing to skate and push offense after being in that defensive shell that almost led to another blown 2-goal lead earlier in this game. At 11:03 of the third period, it's Lankinen coming up with a save on Foligno's jam off of Bedard's setup from below the goal line. Really good greasy scoring opportunity here by Foligno. He goes to the net hard and certainly is willing to compete, battle, and pay the price, and he did so in this situation. Lankinen gets the best of him, though. 12:15 of the third period, there's Johnson scoring his fifth goal of the season. It was Corey Perry absolutely raising all kinds of hell with Roman Josi there in the blue paint, and the sharp angle shot goes off of Yossi's pant leg and into the net. Lankinen never really had a chance on this one. Johnson's fifth goal of the season makes it 3-2 in favor of the Nashville Predators. Chicago's second goal of the game. That with a little bit of life, the Blackhawks go back to working at 14:26. Soderblom keeps them in the game with a big save on Parsonen. We'd see the empty net scenario at 17:57 of the third period. It would take all the way to 19:49 of the third period before Cole Smith would get the empty net goal for the Nashville Predators. His fourth goal of the season, also the team's fourth goal of the game, giving the Preds a 4-2 win. And it would be Seth Jones and his plan to tie this game going all wrong as he tried to go spin-a-rama with sick skill in the neutral zone. He ends up having the puck stolen from him. And then Cole Smith just outworks his harassment from behind all the way to the empty net, stuffs it in, giving the Preds that 4-2 lead, and final is 4-2 as well. Preds out, shoot Chicago 32-31. A very, very chaotic final 2 minutes of the game with the extra attacker, but neither team was able to take advantage of the scenario. It was just a lot of choppy play, bouncing pucks and plays around the wall until the Nashville Predators got the empty net goal with 11 seconds left, and they get out of there with the victory on home ice at Bridgestone Arena, letting the crowd spill out on an early afternoon right there onto Broadway in the Music City area. Going to be a hell of a party down there. So the Nashville Predators did what they have to do. They get a victory. It wasn't the prettiest game ever, but they led all the way through. They did not blow a 2-goal lead in this game, and that is fantastic news. Now, it's going to take a much better game, much better effort to beat their next opponent, the Colorado Avalanche, but for today, the Nashville Predators carry the victory 3-2 on home ice over division rival Chicago Blackhawks and avoid being in last place at the end of this weekend. That's going to do it for the Reed Report's full game recap, full analysis, stats, box score, and more coming up next right here on the Renegades of Puck podcast.
Hello, hello, hello. I'm Tracy, owner-operator of Strong Style Fitness. And that's me and my training assistant, Rizzo. And we are here to bring you fitness that meets you where you are by offering circuit classes, bar-inspired classes, Tabata workouts, boot camps, guided stretching, and more. All taught by a certified personal trainer, me. To learn more, go to our website, strongstylefit.com. Subscribe on YouTube at Strong Style Fitness. Follow on social media at Strong Style Fit. But most importantly, let's get you moving. It doesn't matter if it's your first workout or you've been doing it for years. Strong Style Fitness has the workout that meets you on your journey and helps you along the path to a happier, healthier life. I understand where you've been, what you were going through, and where you were going, and I want to take you there. We'll see you on the mat. Mwah.
Welcome back in Renegades of Puck podcast. Let's get to some analysis of this Nashville Predators Chicago Blackhawks game. Lankanen was 29 out of 31, a really solid effort. Good to see the backup goaltender get a home start. You don't see that a whole lot throughout the season. So for Lankanen, although he had a rough first start of the season, when he got his first start finally, he has looked better and better ever since, and he's had some really incredible stretches of hockey. 29 out of 31, and the shorthanded save on the breakaway that he made was a critical moment and very, very important to this game. So Lankanen, really good, strong performance, and the home crowd was certainly into what he was doing out there. This is truly the note of the game, the greasy jam that was brought by the Nashville Predators. It's something that just hasn't really been there, not consistently enough, and we saw it. And Nyquist, Trenin, Smith, all three of them score goals in this game, and all three of those goals were incredibly hard-working goals. I want to break it down a little bit more than that, but just bringing up the point of how much determination and grit, all of the words you want to associate with winning hockey, were involved with these players and how they scored their goals. Let's start with the Nyquist goal. He had a goal, also had two shots on goal, led the forwards in time on ice at 19:33, and showed incredible skill. Gets to the rebound. First of all, perfect positioning there to get to the rebound. Kicks the rebound from his skate blade to his stick blade and then tucks it into the empty net. That is an incredible goal, an incredible jam. And Nyquist, we all know the storyline, becoming a father for the third time over the weekend. So Nyquist gets totally rewarded with the goal, the time on ice, and the brings the jam and the skill and rewards his coach for trusting him in that. Jakob Trenin, we've talked about him lately, and welcome back. There he is. That's the Yakov Trenin we've been cheering for the last several years. He had a goal. He had assist. He had 2 points this game. He had two hits. He had a block shot. That's the Yakov Trenin that's been missing from the lineup. When he plays his game like that, the Nashville Predators always have opportunities to win. It was great to see him. It's great to see him getting his game back in form after, you know, we frankly took him to the woodshed not that long ago. But Trenin's goal also comes greasy. It was a turnover. He gets into the good hard area right there in the slot and gets the shot. Good job by Yakov Trenin. Smith, McCarron, and Tomasino, not just a fourth line on this particular day. 2 goals, 2 assists for 4 points, 5 shots on goal, and had the best compete level out of any of the groupings out there on the ice at any point in time. The combination goal where McCarron dug the puck out of the corner. Tomasino put the puck on net, and Smith does the double jam rebound. Impressive work by the entire line right there. They were noticeable all night long, and there's nothing fancy about the game that those three are playing right now. It's straight ahead, it's physical, and it's competitive, and they were rewarded with that. And you know what? For people who say McCarron shouldn't be in the lineup because someone else deserves that spot, Michael McCarron goes out there and earns that time. Every shift he's out there, he does something that's relatively noticeable, whether it's winning a faceoff, going hard to the net, putting a big hit on someone. McCarron has proven to be a very reliable player for this National Predators team. And while you would like to see Philip Tomasino playing perhaps with some more high-skilled players, Philip Tomasino put in a good, hard-working game, and he's done that the last couple opportunities he's had. And Smith, honestly, had one of the best games of any Nashville Predator. Deserves to be singled out and recognized for his two goals, three shots on goal, three hits, and 1:37 shorthanded time on ice, which was only 1 second less than the leader for all forwards on shorthand time on ice. Cole Smith was absolutely great in this game. And the empty net goal, you don't normally talk about the effort on an empty net goal, but the harassment from Seth Jones from behind, the amount of slashes, stick checks, hooks, holds, all of that, and then Smith finally tucking the puck in the net. Great job by Cole Smith. I did make a note because I question what happened right here. Luke Evangelista completely disappeared. 10:52 in total time on ice. The only thing he has on his stat line is two shots missed. Not really sure what happened with Luke Evangelista in this game. Not sure if something was bothering him or he ended up at the end of the bench, but that's something we'll look more into. We'll talk more about later, but I thought it was highly curious to look and see Luke Evangelista had virtually no stat line in this game, considering he was skating on the second line to start the game. Did have 57 seconds of power play time and 13 shifts, but just simply did not get anything registered there. So that's going to do it for the analysis when it comes to me. We still got the good cold hard numbers known as the mock score coming up. Brian Bass is coming up, and we got a close coming up that's got some stick taps and something really great and fun that happened on the broadcast yesterday. So let's get to it. Let's hear from Strike Digital, and let's get the next break in from our great sponsors and friends. This is the Renegades of Puck podcast, back right after this. The digital environment can be quite intimidating, time-consuming, and cumbersome, especially with all those other areas that need attention at your business, and that's why Stripe Digital Solutions is here to help. I know, because that's exactly what Stripe Digital Solutions did for me and the Renegades of Puck. From designing my home website and helping me create my merchandise to special event posters, brand building, and social media management. But it's not just that. It's so much more. Stripe Digital Solutions has helped me every step of the way. From startup to full-time operation, Stripe Digital Solutions has been there to assist and advise every single step of the journey. In today's fast-paced world, the path to success is having a strong digital partner, and nobody is better in the trenches than Brandy and Stripe Digital Solutions. Get the solution before it's even a problem with Stripe Digital Solutions. Welcome back in Renegades of Puck podcast. When it comes to the good cold hard numbers of the box score, Cole Smith leading the Nashville Predators with two goals in this game. Yakov Trenin also chips in a goal. Nyquist chips in a goal. When it comes to assists, nobody on the Preds with more than one. Let's go down the list. Forsberg, McCarron, O'Reilly, Sissons, Tomasino, and Trenin all with assists from the forward side of things. Dante Favreau, the only point out of the defense core in this game, in this victory for the Nashville Predators. When it comes to shots on goal, five by Philip Forsberg, pace the Nashville Predators, four by the captain, Roman Josi, and then a bunch with three, but I wanted to point out who this grouping was with three. It was Luzon, who's continued putting up good shots on goal and taking advantage of his opportunity to move up to the second pair on the defense. Cole Smith scored two goals on three shots. Sherwood had three shots, and Parsonen also had three shots. Just wanted everybody to know about that, because Parsonen's game, of course, is coming to question as of late. I think Parsonen's using that big frame and getting to the net and going to the hard areas much better the last couple of games. Like to continue seeing him get some more opportunities. Block shots, it was Stastny coming into the lineup for his first game with the Nashville Predators, getting three block shots in this game and leading the Nashville Predators. He also got a shot on goal in his game in his 15:52 in total time on ice. In the physical category, it was Luzon with five hits in this game, and they were noticeable, that is for sure, against this Blackhawks team. Sissons had four, Cole Smith had three in this game. Time on ice leaders when it comes to the forwards. Nyquist gets that dad strength and that extra energy, 19:33, and time on ice leads all forwards, 19:20. 12 by O'Reilly is second, 18-16 by Philip Forsberg is your third time on ice leader. So the top line leads the way as usual. The captain, Roman Josi, led the team in total time on ice, 25-22, followed up by Dante Fabbro, 21-03. Fabbro, again, putting up another really nice game. In the special teams operations, it was Nyquist with 4-11 in total time on ice skated. Forsberg at 4-03, Josi with 4-01. Special teams on the penalty kill side of things. Out of the forwards, it was Nyquist with 138 total time on ice on the PK, 137 for Cole Smith. On the defensive side of things, 230 for Dante Fabbro shorthanded, 224 for Luzon shorthanded. So a really good job by the Nashville Predators special teams. And speaking of those special teams, 1-for-3 on the power play and the faceoff winning percentage, 56.1% in favor of the Predators. They generated 28 hits in this game, 14 block shots, had 8 takeaways, but 9 giveaways. They lost that particular part of the battle in this stats game. That's going to do it for my portion of the box score, but we got to hear from Brian Baston. He's got the charts you need to see and the numbers you need to know. Coming to you from Bridgestone Arena. He was in the locker room. He talked to players, talked to the coach, and here's his report from Bridgestone Arena. Brian, the show belongs to you.
Thanks a lot, Charlie. Well, I am here in Bridgestone Arena following the 4-2 victory by the Nashville Predators over the Chicago Blackhawks. And the big hyped matchup with Connor Bedard coming to town ended up being kind of a quiet night for him. Obviously, Nashville players, including Kevin Lincoln, were impressed by the skills that Connor Bedard brought to the game. But the team was much more focused on the things and the players that went well during this game. Now, obviously, we all got a little bit nervous. Nashville did go jump out to a 2-0 lead, the fourth time in 5 games that they've done so. And the previous 3 times, they've all blown that lead. And so when Chicago notched one early to cut the score to 2-1, there was a little bit of anxiety. And it's safe to say that a lot of people were worried about them blowing that lead. But Nashville was able to respond and walk out of here with a 4-2 victory. But one of the things I want to talk about is a guy that, you know, he did get on the score sheet but didn't produce, you know, a lot of wow numbers that we would see. But that's only if you're looking at shots and goals and assists and everything like that. So for tonight's one big stat, we're going to talk about a player who has really been fighting for a spot on this roster and in the lineup night in and night out. So tonight's one big stat is about the man, Philip Tomasino. Now, Philip Tomasino did end the night with a primary assist on the first Cole Smith goal. He did play about 10 minutes at 5-on-5, but what he was doing all over the ice made a massive difference, even if he didn't get, he only ended up with 1 point on the evening. When he was on the ice at 5-on-5, Nashville led in total shot attempts 10-5. That's a percentage of 67%. For shots, when Tomasino was on the ice, the Predators led 7-3, which is 70%. And in expected goals, which is shot quality, the Predators had 0.82 expected goals while he was on the ice, and Chicago managed only 0.07 expected goals. That is a total of 93%. So when Philip Tomasino was on the ice at 5-on-5, the team was protecting the puck better, maintaining possession better, getting more shots on goal, and dominating the quality of those shots. Now, again, he did finish the day with just 2 shots on goal, one of those on the power play and the primary assist, but he was responsible for creating that rebound that was essential for Cole Smith's first goal. And if you were worried about Philip Tomasino and his role in this lineup, obviously, you know, he put on a great performance today, and hopefully that does solidify his spot back in this lineup because he played very well, and I think he was one of the key players outside the goal scorers tonight. And that's tonight's one big stat. Charlie?
Thank you so much, Brian. Sure to appreciate all the hard work and effort you put into covering this game from Bridgestone Arena and all of the videos and clips that you uploaded. Make sure you check out Brian on social media. Follow him along at On the Four Check as well. Brian's an incredible, incredible talent when it comes to the numbers. Again, he's got the charts you need to see and the numbers you need to know. The one and only Brian Baston from OnTheFourCheck.com. That's going to do it for operation number 822. So let's go ahead and close this thing out. And this was a lot of fun yesterday on the broadcast. Obviously not expecting this, never expecting this. And I never seek these things out. I never drop into the DMs and things and say, can you give me a shout out on the air or anything like that. But yesterday it was incredibly great to see Willie Donick drop the Renegades of Puck name on the broadcast right after their interview with the world-class maniac Eric Young, incredible professional wrestler and great friend of the show and great friend to the Renegades of Puck overall. So Willie and Mace shoehorning the Renegades of Puck into the broadcast yesterday, into the end of that interview was very, very nice. And thank you, Stick Taps. Love and respect to all of you involved with that. And I appreciate everyone on the broadcast. It was truly a surprise, and it meant a lot. And I thank you guys so much. It was just a lot of fun. So you saw the clip right there, and you got a chance to hear from the broadcast. So awesome job, and I sure do appreciate everybody over there working really hard behind the scenes on the Predators broadcast. They do a very good job, and they work very hard. I happen to know that because I've been around them for many, many years now, and I know many of them very well. So thank you, Willie. I sure do appreciate you doing that, and I sure do appreciate you giving the Renegades of Puck a good mention on a nice Saturday afternoon. Crazy Kyle also played our secret song, so it was a really good day for the Renegades of Puck when it came to the broadcast. That's going to do it. Operation 822. We're going to get this one in the books. It's a busy, busy week for Thanksgiving week. We've got Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Sunday games coming up. So we will be here covering each and every bit of it. I've already laid out the week's plan. I'm actually very excited about bringing you this week of coverage. We'll have the Avalanche. We'll have the Calgary Flames, the St. Louis Blues, and we'll have the Winnipeg Jets all in this week against the Nashville Predators. So it's going to be a lot of fun. Looking forward to it. Operation number 822 is in the books. I appreciate each and every one of you for your viewership. Appreciate your time, and most importantly, I appreciate you. I'm your host and Captain Crazy Charlie Sonia. Stick Taps, love and respect.